let's talk about syncing video. I mean, yeah. I think that's obviously a problem sometimes. we've all seen video out of sync, and you know, I've been on gigs where we're trying to just eyeball it and hope it works, and it doesn't always go well.
Sure. So when we're doing a live production, the video guys are over there doing the video thing, and the audio guys are over here doing the audio thing, and we're largely ignoring each other and calling each other bad names behind each other's back, because that's what we do, because that's just part of the game. But one of the biggest challenges the video department has is that all the processing that they do, because they do a bunch of processing just like we do in audio land, it's all digital, just like it is in audio land, but the amount of data that they're dealing with is exponentially larger than what we deal with. Video is a lot of bandwidth, a lot of data, even for a really simple, low resolution video. And as soon as you get into HD or 4K or whatever, it's a lot of data. And, you know, if they need to adjust the frame rate, or they're cutting between cameras, or they're processing, or they're anything, whatever it is that they're doing stuff just like we do stuff. It takes time. Most typical video systems that are on the shows that I do, from, you know, hitting the camera to coming out the other side, typically between 80 milliseconds to even as much as about 140, 150 milliseconds is how long it takes to get through the whole chain. You'll hear video people talk about it as how many frames it takes to go through. They like to use the word frames, and I like to look at them and go, I don't know from frames, because I'm a millisecond guy, because I'm an audio person. Sure. But yeah, you know, you'll ask them how much latency. They'll say it's 3.5 frames. But that's just another reason for us to, you know, complain to each other and carp and moan and fight. But essentially, it takes a while for their stuff to get through the system. So when we're embedding our audio after it gets through all their stuff, it's probably taken 5 milliseconds to get through all of our chain. I mean, you know, typical mixing consoles now, the internal latency is sub 2 millisecond. You know, different consoles are different, depends on the processing, blah, 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 blah. But even worst case scenario, you know, we're not doing more than 8 to 10 milliseconds of total processing time to get all the way through from the microphone all the way to that output. So We're taking 10 milliseconds, and that's the slow lane, and they're at 120. So we come together at the end, and we're 110 milliseconds ahead of them. And obviously, that's not good. And it's not good for one, you want things to be in time, but there's another thing I like to talk about, which is, and it took me a while to realize this, when video and audio are not in sync with each other, it matters which way they're not in sync. And I'll tell you what I mean by that. If audio happens before video, it is a very unnatural feeling thing. And so if audio is even 10 milliseconds before video, most people will be, it doesn't look right. Like you can tell very quickly. But if audio is behind video, so I see the video before I hear the sound, I see the lips move before I hear the sound, the humans are much more tolerant of that effect. You can be 30, even 50 milliseconds off before people start to notice it. And the reason for it is really simple. In our real lives, day to day, audio moves way slower than video does. So if Scott is standing 50 feet away from me in an arena and yelling at me about why I brought the wrong microphone, or he needs the chain motors to be put over wherever, his audio is 50 milliseconds behind his video. I see his lips move instantaneously, because speed of light is, for all intents and purposes, instantaneous. And 50 milliseconds later, I hear his voice. This is something we experience all the time. We think nothing about it. In fact, talking to someone in the same room, they're 10 milliseconds behind, they're 15 milliseconds behind. So we have a lot more tolerance for that. As soon as it goes the other direction, it's very like cognitive dissonance, like, this feels very weird. And the situation that we find ourselves in from a technical standpoint is exactly that situation. The audio is ahead of the video because it's taken the video so much longer. And so that's why sync is so important to align back in place, because we're creating a situation that is very unnatural to view. It just feels very wrong. And it's obvious to everyone that it feels very wrong. So that's why it's so critical for us to be able to align those things. The great news is that adding delay to audio is easy. We've been adding delay to audio for 40 years. It's a relatively simple process. Now, to be very clear, when we're talking about delaying our audio, it's not like I'm adding a delay as an effect. It's literally I'm taking my entire signal and I'm just going to push it back by 80 milliseconds. I'm just going to push it back by 60 milliseconds. I'm going to slow it down by that amount so that then when it hits the video and they embed, they're in sync with each other. But, and this is where, you know, the devil is in the details, because I see this mistake happen a lot, where we eyeball it and we clap at a microphone and we move our delay time on our output until it matches. But what are we looking at? Yeah. What is it we're actually eyeballing to? Because that's the critical component that often gets missed. What are we actually eyeballing to? And does aligning to that actually solve the problem? So I'll use a live sound reinforcement situation that's, you know, Scott, maybe you've been in, where you have an IMAX screen and somebody claps at a thing and then you dial the delay that's in order to align to that IMAX screen. Well, first of all, the IMAX screen is probably an LED wall. The LED wall by itself is probably adding another 100 milliseconds of latency.
Right.
Aside from everything else in the video chain, LED walls take forever because there's a lot of processing going on in there. So now I already am time aligning to something that has additional latency to what the output of my video may be to go to a stream. They're two different reference points. Secondly, I'm doing it from front of house. So I am 100 feet away from the stage. So the audio I'm listening to is 100 milliseconds later than what's coming out. So again, my reference point, like, what am I referencing to? And so that's the point that I'm making. It's not so much that I'm beating up on people for time aligning to LED walls and speakers, because there's validity to that for certain situations. But the bottom line is, when you're talking about doing sync of audio to video, the critical thing to think about is, where am I monitoring that? And that means, where am I monitoring the video and the audio? You know, what is my actual monitoring environment? Most people don't realize that most video monitors have inherent latency built into them just to process the video that goes into them and generate a picture. So most video monitors, especially computer monitors, televisions are really bad about this. They have a certain amount of latency built in. So even if I put my embedded audio and video into a television and I use the speakers and I look at that and I use that as my reference point, the video and the audio may not be aligned in the television.
Right. Yeah.
So you're still not really dealing with, you know, a real aligned situation. It's like, okay, I've timed it so it works good in this TV, but that doesn't mean it's going to look good on the tail end of my broadcast path. It just means it worked on this TV, which apparently, oops, had like 75 milliseconds of video delay built into it, and I didn't know. I've used very expensive video devices that have a screen and audio and whatever. And timed to those, you know, using that, like put my headphones in and plugged into SDI. And I'm like, this is a freaking $8,000 box, you know, and timed to that. And then took a long time to figure this one out, several years, frankly, only to find out that the video screen in that was 15 milliseconds off.
Right.
And so again, it's all reference point. Like what am I referring to? So say all that to say this, if you're doing true broadcast, the only really accurate timing reference place is a true, they tend to call them color accurate monitors because video people use them to judge color. Sony makes a whole line of these. They nearly always have a headphone jack in them. They are hideously expensive. They're usually like $10,000 for one stupid little monitor, but they are engineered to be in time. So if you're literally wanting to judge your embedded signal directly from an SDI, you really need to really get it right. You need that. You need somebody with headphones on, looking at that screen, and that's where they're then judging, is this in time or not? That's assuming that you're going to eyeball it. By the same token, if you're streaming, you don't really care if it's in time anywhere except on the other end of the stream. That's the only part that matters. If that's your delivery, that's your audience, it just has to be in time on the end of the stream.